can hold you.
We sound crazy.
I mean, but I'm glad that you touched on having anxiety and being anxious before, you know, speaking engagements, because I think we all deal with it in our own way. Yeah. Like, you know, I'm a very shy person, you know.
Really?
Believe it or not.
Yeah, I really am. I'm very, like, if you recall from when we first started the show, I didn't want to do the live event.
That's true.
You didn't want to film it.
I didn't want to film it. Didn't want to do it. I was like, no, let's just keep it audio. But because it's just like, what advice would you give brothers out there, like just who are in, whether they in sports or in music or whatever profession, like, because at some point public speaking is important. Mm-hmm. Just being around people and being social at events, because not everybody wants to go to the event and network and meet and greet new people.
Yeah.
Like, what are some tips that you would offer?
You know, one of the things that I do, man, is how I center myself is, and you brothers can do it now, is I take my hand and put it over my heart. And I take in literally three breaths and I do like three of those. Two things that it does. For one, it slows your heart rate down. Mm. Because when there's a thought of anxiousness, it increases the heart rate.
Mm-hmm.
So when the heart rate is elevated, of course, some people palms get sweaty.
Mm-hmm.
Some people itch. Some people become very fidgety. But what this does, it slows the heart rate down. But having your hand over your chest also allows you to feel the rhythm of your heart.
Mm.
So now you connect with the essence of you as a being, that I'm alive. Mm. So it brings me back to the moment, because anxiety is just the fear of the unknown and the fear of what ifs and, you know, what if this don't work and what if I'm not ready? And it's all those different thoughts, man. So I always tell brothers, man, to center themselves with that. It's simple. It's nothing, you know, you know, it's big, or, you know what I mean, grand, but it's something that's simple. And then also closing your eyes, man, because the one thing that we don't do well in this day and age is, like, man, we don't stay in the moment.
Mm-hmm.
Do not stay in the damn moment.
Like,
I know I'm guilty of that.
And one of the things that I have to remind myself, like, don't worry about what you're going to say before you hit the stage. Stay in this moment.
Mm.
And as I stay in the moment, it allows me to embrace the incoming moment, because there's another moment that is coming behind the moment that you're in.
Mm.
So as I'm walking onto stage, I'm just embracing all of these incoming moments. And then the moment that my hand touched that mic, I always start out with something, especially if I'm giving a talk centered around mental health. I always start out, I'll find something to make everyone laugh.
Mm-hmm.
And and after that, I'm just kind of like, all right, we got that out the way. All right, so let's talk.
Mm-hmm.
And you watch everybody just ease
and
just come to this place where they're settled, because you can't pour from an unsettled space. So you have to settle yourself. You have to settle your thoughts. You have to settle your energy. You have to settle your spirit. And now your body is settled.
Mm.
And as your body settled, now you can own the moment.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
And whatever happens in the moment, right, it's not like I'm trying to prepare for if it goes bad. If it goes left, I'm moving left.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
mm-hmm.
I'm not fighting the resistance that if it goes left, they don't receive it. You know what I mean? It's just like, no, I'm just going to, you know, I remember this lady, I was doing a speaking engagement, man, and the mic went out. And, you know, she was just kind of like, I'm so sorry. This is. I said, it's okay. And I sat down and I talked to the people.
Mm-hmm.
I said, we just gonna talk. And while she was here, I was like, no, because if you get here, this is gonna shut everybody's receptors down and they won't receive.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Because your anxiety is gonna be projected into the audience and it's infectious. And everybody else gonna be like, oh, what's gonna happen? The mic is off and it's all these people, and you know what I mean? And so it was, I don't know, it was like a breaker went out or something. And I said, it's okay.
Mm.
And you would be amazed of the people who sat and received without the sound.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was a moment of, it was an organic moment that happened. And this is how we should handle life. I'm not saying don't be prepared and don't plan, but there are moments that's gonna happen that we didn't plan for.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the best thing that we can do is understand the power of a pivot.
Mm. The power of a pivot.
Hello?
I'm taking notes over here.
New book. New book. The power of a pivot.
There's power in it.
That's crazy.
You know? And so in that moment, man, I'm like, oh, this wasn't what I planned for, but man, I'm ready for it. You know? And I think another thing that I'm seeing too, and I just feel pulled to go in this direction, is like we have so many, especially us as black men now, we're first generation success story.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of us are, because even success can feel traumatizing.
That was my next question, was to talk about the fear of success and how that's a big part of your of trauma, and why I need therapy is just having to like deal with what it means to be the first or the only, or how lonely or isolating that feels, or just the scariness of the unknown of your being the trailblazer. It's heavy stuff.
Man, you know, it's funny you said about being a trailblazer. I'm going to do a talk next month, and I've titled it The Guilt of Blazing Trails.
Mm.
The Guilt of Blazing Trail, because we often battle with who we have to leave behind.
Mm-hmm.
And we battle, wow. And we battle with having to process who we have to become.
Mm-hmm.
Because when success is happening, you do have to become someone new. I'm not saying in your personality at your core, but you have to move different.
You do. Yeah.
You know, you have to eat different. You know, if you're touring, if you're on the road, like, so there's so many different dynamics of success that we weren't prepared for.
Mm.
Right? So we just felt, go get the bag. But then we got the bag, and we was just like, oh my God, all this come with the bag?
Mm-hmm.
The stress, and then you have to deal with how people view you. Then you got to deal with, do you like me because I'm a genuine person, or do you like me because you want to get next to this person? Mm-hmm. You have to deal with, so your guard is always up, and that's exhausting. If you always got your shield up,
mm-hmm.
when do you ever have a moment to relax? And so that's traumatizing. Mm-hmm. Because while everybody's on the outside looking at, oh my God, he's with this person, he's taking pictures with her, but you're going home and sitting down and just like, this is a lot.
Mm-hmm.
This is a lot.
It sounds familiar.
Yeah, sounds story of my life.
I'm like, speaking of my life Lord. Right now.
Sounds very
it's crazy
familiar.
That you talked about the power of a pivot, because the last couple years, my consistent New Year's resolution is like, tomorrow be a bit more spontaneous. Like, I'm a very cross every T, dot every I kind of person. Like, I gotta know what's happening. And a lot of times, if it's kind of thrown off, then that will cause me to, it's like, oh my God, what is happening? And then it's just like, okay, tomorrow, it's gonna work out either way. So yeah, it's I've definitely been pushing myself to, you know, just kind of settle in the fact that, you know, it's okay to kind of veer off the path from time to time. So yeah, amazing.
And sometimes the veering off is where you get to discover new levels of who you are.
Yeah.
That most times. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
You know, because it stretches you.
Yeah. But it's funny, but what me and Chuck talked about a lot recently is what I've discovered, because we tour together, we do a lot of stuff together, so we're like side of stage, about to go on at the same time. You feel that you have a shared anxiety. But it's interesting, I'm starting to recognize how close, how similar anxiety and excitement are.
Yeah.
They're like twins. And so you can either translate it as like the sky is falling, or it feels almost as exciting as the first day of school.
Mm.
They're really similar in how they feel in your body, what your voices tell yourself in your brain. And so I try to stop and check and see, like, am I excited? And that's a good thing, because it's about to be fun. You're about to get on a roller coaster. Or am I really anxious because I think the world is going to end or I'm going to die? And a lot of times that kind of puts in perspective how serious I should be worrying about stuff. Like, because getting out, like, I always say, I love what I do, but we're also not... It's not open heart surgery. Like, we perform or we write music or we do things in the creative space, and it's healing, but it's not literally life or death. And so sometimes that anxiousness feels like life or death, but it's really the excitement of like, it's music and I can't wait to, almost like sports too. You're just like, I want to get out there and give it to them. And that feels very similar to a panic.
Yeah, yeah, it can. And I think too, leaning into both of them, right? Mm. I'm excited about this opportunity, but I'm also afraid of this opportunity.
I'm afraid of the opportunity, yeah.
You know what I mean? And I think you can take them both with you. I remember counseling a family that had lost one of their loved ones, man, and it was very tragic. And one of the things that I say, I actually just eulogized my friend's son who passed of an overdose in January, and 37. And I remember telling him, you know, and you know, he's been my friend, man, 10 plus years. And he was like, man, no, I'm good, bro. I'm strong. I said, nigga, no, you're not.
You're not good. You're not good.
You're not good. Mm-hmm. And I think, again, Black culture, we have this it's a dissonance, and then it's an expectation. We're strong, mm-hmm. you know. And I said, bro, and I even remember telling the family, it's okay to fall apart. Mm. You know, this whole I can't. It irritates my spirit when I hear people. You got to be strong for the family. Be strong for my. No, this is a time where I need to be weak. Mm. This is a time where I need to mourn. This is a time where I need to cry. I need to fall apart. I need to break down. And I said to him, bro, you can hold both. You can say you're good, but you can also say, man, I just lost my child. Mm. Mm-hmm. This is your son.
Yeah.
I said, you're not supposed to be good.
Yeah.
If you were good, I'm questioning.
Right. Yeah.
But you, and we have to become more of humanity. Humanizing these experiences, because social media says, hey, you got to be stoic and put it on. And, you know, it's like, man, I went through a tough breakup, man. My homeboy, I was on the road I'm hopping on stage, pouring into men. And my homeboy texts me and he says, I need to cry. And I said, man, me too. And he's like, bro, he says, just I just got to process some things. And he said, I feel like you need to as well. And so he calls me. I answer the phone. I say, hey, what's up, bro? He says, you've been out here on this road pouring into all these men. You continue getting on stage, giving these brothers all you got. And he said, I know what you're going through. Mm. You hadn't talked about the breakup. You hadn't talked about it. He said, I know what you're going through, bro. Mm. He says, Jay, take off your cape, man. And he says, I need you to cry. And, bro, I broke down. I'm talking about I cried like a baby because I was grieving the end of this relationship. Mm. But then also still stuck in the element of a healer. Mm-hmm. But in this moment, he's talking me through it, and he says, bro, it's okay, you know, because I was trying to hold everything. I was trying to hold my relationship together and trying to hold this tour together and trying to hold myself together, you know, and he says, man, I just need you to just let this out for 30 minutes, bro, for 30 minutes. And he just sat there on the phone, and he said, I'm not getting off this phone until you get it out. Mm. And if we had more of those spaces. Mm-hmm. And I encourage brothers, if you don't have a brother that you can pick up the phone and just break down, you need to reevaluate, because this Superman and this put the hood on my back, you know what I'm saying? As these rappers say, this whole I'm gonna carry the family legacy, man, is killing us. It's killing us. Mm-hmm. Because what is happening is there are no phone booths. Mm-hmm. So where's Superman changing that?
Mm. It's real.
And the phone booth is really a safe space. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So is that a relationship? Is that a circle of friends? Or is that your therapist, your counselor? What is that for you? Mm-hmm. And I always ask, brother, where's your phone booth? Mm. Where do you go to take off your cape? Yeah. Where do you go to just be? And I know for me, man, at this point, and especially even in a love relationship, I have to be able to just be.
Yeah.
I don't want to be Jay the therapist. I don't want to be Jay the speaker, the author. I just want to be. Mm-hmm. Those are things that I do. And yes, I'm very connected to it, but that's not who I am.
Yeah.
And I think we need more spaces for us to just be, where you don't have to be looked at as feel as Capitol Records, CNO, and all those different things, where you can just sit down like, man, ain't nobody asking you about this. Ain't nobody. Just like yesterday, I hung out with my niece and nephew. It was fun because around them, I'm just Uncle JJ.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And, man, it is the best, because we know when we step on the red carpet, when we step in an event, it's just everybody's pulling on you. Mm-hmm. And I have worked to say, where can I be in a space where I don't have to be poor, where I can be poured into? And I think we need more spaces where we're poured into rather than poured on. Mm. Because there's this level of exhaustion that I'm seeing in brothers, man, that I'm talking about, you know, brothers coming in the session, soon they click on the link, just breaking down. And I remember telling this one bro guy, my client, I said, man, come, it's okay, bro. And he just kept saying, Jay, I'm tired. Mm. I'm tired. I'm doing this for my wife. I'm doing this for the family. And it's just like everybody else is living life, but I have all the stresses of providing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, man.
And then we get flowers at the funeral.
At the funeral.
Wow. Don't give my flowers. Don't eat no fried chicken on my account.
Like, please, please don't.
You know, man, the people will always eat fried chicken at the funeral and bring, don't bring chicken. No sodas to my mama.
You don't want no sodas?
I mean, I don't want none of that, man. No, whoever, you know what I mean? I just, hey, we don't want that. But seriously, I just, it's real life out here. And when I think about months ago, I was at the Usher concert in Las Vegas. And after the show, I was backstage in Usher's dressing room, not name dropping. I'm just telling you the setting.
Yeah.
But Twitch was back there. And we had a full conversation because we were all waiting for Usher to change and come back out in the room. But it was just me, Twitch, and his wife. And I'm like, we had a great convo, exchanged info. It was just, it blew me away when everything happened some months back because I didn't see any signs. Mm. I didn't see anything that was like, oh, he was seen down or sad. He was energetic. He was happy. We were saying we were going to connect next time I was in LA. It was crazy. But just, it just blows my mind how people are struggling and hurt and in pain and just don't feel like they can cry out for help.
No. And I would venture to say that the majority of us are close to that edge.
Yeah.
And not admitting it for lots of reasons. And I think the world we live in now, the technological world we live in now, the social media world we live in now, creates a vacuum where there's really no shutting off at all. And so, I mean, I definitely have felt that I'm tired. I feel underappreciated. I've felt that many times. And you're right. You just don't know when someone's going to, like, snap, for lack of a better word. Yeah. But it allows me to be empathetic to everyone. Like, my biggest concern in a day is over everything, over the work, is just, like, what keeps me up at night is how I affect the people during the day. Because I'm always so scared of being the person that triggers that to happen to somebody. Because I understand that words are really powerful.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Moods are powerful. Rejection is powerful. All that stuff. So I'm always just like, because I know that I'm fragile, if we're keeping it real. I know my heart is fragile. So I'm always like, God, if I'm this way, I want to make sure I'm not creating any excess damage to anybody else. And I know it's not easy because you don't always know. But we also have to walk. We shouldn't be walking on eggshells, but not empathy as a cool word, but empathy in its true meaning. Like, you really have to try your best to put yourself in people's shoes and imagine what they're going through because you're going through something.
Yeah. And I think, too, it's like, I always reach out to Phil. Whenever he has a high moment that is public size, I always reach out to him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because, believe it or not, that's when most of us experience our lowest moment.
Yeah. 100%.
You know what I mean? I always, you know, and that's like Charlamagne, like everybody I'm connected to in the industry, I always reach out to them when they're plastered all over the world that he just did this or she just did that. Always like, man, how are you feeling? Mm. Because again, you get this rush of just this dopamine, right? Of just, oh my God, congratulations, man. I'm so happy for you, this and that. But then, because I've been there.
Mm-hmm.
I know what it's like to stand on the platform and you just, yeah, and you go back to your room, you just like, I don't know if I can do this any longer.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's important, going back to what you said, to be more empathetic, but also, like, I'm not saying that I don't trust smiles, but I've learned to look beyond this.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, with Twitch situation, I mean, you think about the sequence of this. He and his wife has just celebrated their anniversary.
Mm-hmm.
They just posted a dance video.
Mm-hmm.
So that tells you that this was something that had been turning in his head. It's just most men, when the things I've had to sit through, I was in shock how it happened because I've seen brothers go home, kiss their wife and kids, give the wife flowers, have sex with their wife, and get up the next morning, go sit in the car, bam. And wow. People say, well, how do you do it? It was just a sequence of events. And what they'll do is they'll say goodbye without saying it. Mm. You know what I mean? Like, you know, we'll study patterns of people who have passed by way of suicide. And you look at that because what happened is there's this, it's almost like a volcano effect. And it's just a moment of eruption. And this is why when I'm talking to brothers, man, I don't ask a guy, how you doing? Because that's centered around performance. Because mm-hmm. You ask them about how you're doing, they can tell you everything. Yeah, man, you know, we're doing this. It's always, how you feeling? That way, they can connect with their emotion, but then also gives me an opportunity if I need to hold space in that to a brother. Like, I got seven of my guys, we were on text thread every day, and I have a chain of emotions that are colors. And each color represents something. One says, man, I'm good, you know, just pacing myself. One says, man, I'm not good. If y'all can pray for me. One says, hey, like, I need the cavalry. Mm. Like, it's about five different emotions. And when I tell you, it's a game changer for each of us. Because even if we can't talk, I can send this color and brothers know immediately what to start doing.
Man, that's powerful. We should do that.
Yeah, I'll send it to you, Phil.
Yeah, man.
We should definitely do that.
Yeah, I'll send it to you. Yeah.
We sound crazy.
So, just heal, bro. This journal, this right here, which, by the way, y'all got copies, by the way.
Yeah. Finally.
You know. Wow.
Thanks, Phil.
Thanks, Phil.
You're a couple hours late.
Wow. Now, I'm grateful for this, so tell them about it, yeah.
But tell us, I mean, how this, because this is a great tool in the midst of everything else, how you balance it, but what can people who purchase, because you need to purchase it, just heal, bro, like, the journal, like, what can people expect? Like, what... Tell us about more about the book.
You know, what people can expect, men and boys, man, there's short stories in there, and I was very conscious. Most brothers don't read. You know, most brothers not reading 200 pages of books, so I was very intentional to not, you know, make it too layered in information, but there's enough in there that takes each person on a journey. With the short stories, with the poems, and with the different discussions that I'm having, and that asks the questions that challenge the brother to begin journaling and writing it out. For me, journaling was the one tool that I fell in love with in therapy because I found my voice. And there's a quote in there that I said, a man who finds his voice finds his way. Mm. When you find your voice, you find your way. When you find your voice, you find you. You find the little boy. You find the missing pieces that have been scattered, and you're able to connect the dots and say, okay, this is why I don't say this, or this is why I respond in this manner. And finding your voice, man, is so powerful because you get to really find those parts of you that you've been missing. Mm-hmm. You know, it was difficult because when my parents divorced, you know, my mom was very dominant and strong, man. So, and I was the only boy. My mom was just, so I couldn't even get a word out. Mm-hmm. You know, mom, I feel, no, you, this ain't, you know, I mean, my mom's like, she got 12 sisters and all of them got their mouths, man. Mm-hmm. So it's like, I learned how to be quiet. And so in relationships, I would be quiet and I couldn't express. And then all of a sudden I would explode. Mm. And so finding my voice was also healing the mother wound because my mom was very dominant and I didn't have a voice. So I was passive in life, but aggressive on the field. And when the field ended, it flipped.
Yeah.
I became aggressive in life and that passivity kind of just drifted into the wind. And so brothers gonna be able to take themselves on a journey, man, and heal the little boy in them, heal the man, heal the wounded parts, you know, uncover those things that we hide and dress up and camouflage with success and cause and all those different things, man. Like, I'm so happy that we're doing more as Black men. We're successful. We get into the bag. We're representing. But what concerns me is, how well are we living? Mm. And as I love to say is that I don't want to be a public success and a private failure in my life. because privately I want to experience peace. I want to experience true rest. I don't want to have to take a pill to get up. I don't want to have to take a pill to lay down. Mm-hmm. We're seeing brothers are necessary with so many different things. It's just like you got to, you know, like I, you got to get on stage with something and you got to get off stage. It's just, and what happens, you become a zombie. Mm-hmm. You know, you become a robot. I mean, you know, I've seen some guys, man, just, you know, and you can just tell they just worn down. Mm-hmm. And one of the brothers was asking me the other day, he was like, man, what's been the secret to aging? And I said, man, healing and therapy, number one. But I said, too, man, not coping with the wrong things, you know? Mm. And because, you know, for us, it's always, as you said, it's all the above. Mm. Sex, drugs, alcohol, or, you know, disassociation by avoidance. Mm. And yeah. So when you wow. are heavily avoiding, you become overly obsessive in other areas.
That's so true, man.
So you're obsessive about making money, but you're majorly avoiding the issues that cause you to spend the money that you make because now there's this void that you're trying to fill because, hey, I'm on now. But the void is just like, man, I wasn't really secure as a child, so now I'm secured by the success. But the reality of it is that I'm really insecure. Mm-hmm. And so the overly obsessiveness, man, is really dangerous because it causes us to be avoidant to a lot of other things. And so I just, you know, pray, man, that this book, which is it has done, and I'm, you know, I'm just blessed to see the impact that I'm making, you know, from my decision to choosing to live, because most people, study shows, most people who fail suicide, they will attempt again. Mm. And to see where my life has turned and to see how I'm helping brothers and to use this story and to use it in a way that's impacting Black men. Because, bro, I've never seen who I am. You know, my parents, my dad's like, I ain't never seen no Black man therapist like you and this and that. Like, I've never seen it. I saw therapists in collar shirts and we're going to talk about this and we're going to talk about some cognitive distortions. It's just like, bro, come on, man. And so here I am in a hoodie and just being me. And it's just like, you know, and it's been great to do it in that way so brothers can relate.
Yeah.
Because I think it's important to be relatable and credible. You know what I mean? And so that's been so humbling, man, to have so many rappers reach out to me, you know, via DM, and I, you know, will send voice messages to them, man, and just like, hey, man, you know, just take a quick break. And it's just because, again, when you're in it, and Phil knows this, like, it's coming fast. And so you don't have time to process. You know, and by the time you do process, man, it's over.
Man, that's so true.
We sound crazy.
And we talked about, obviously, mental health, physical health, emotional. But I want to also talk about the spiritual side, your faith. How has that, because you've talked about some of the valleys you've been in and some of the challenges and two-time suicide survivor. You know what I mean? Like, how has your faith helped you during those low points of your life?
You know, at one time, man, I felt like, you know, God didn't exist because of what I was going through. I was abused by my mom's husband when I was in my teenage years, and he was a minister. And so I had, man, like I said, one day I'm going to write a real book, but the experiences I've had with church, and I'm not going to say church, but with people of the church, because I don't necessarily believe in church hurt. I feel that it's people who are in church that have hurt us. And then it's the expectation that we had of them because they were in church. You know what I mean? Because we expected to be handled better. That's what it was or what it is. And so I just kept saying, like, God, how do you let this happen? Like, again, this dude preached on Sunday and beat me, you know what I'm saying? You know, Monday through Saturday. I'm just like, you know, because he wanted to make a man out of me and all of that. And but, you know, I had this real come to Jesus moment, and I remember God saying to me that I can use all of this. Nothing will be wasted. And I was just like, what did he say? I can use all of this. And I just really started to dig. I'm like, what does that mean? And he said, all of these experiences was making you for the moment that you're in now. Because how is it that I can speak to so many different parts of men because I've lived it? You know what I mean? And so, and that makes your witness that much greater because I can now meet you where you are because I was in that valley. You know what I mean? And now my understanding is that when you get to the mountaintop, what you realize is just an upside down valley.
Hello? That tickle, that was so damn real.
Yeah.
The mountaintop is an upside down valley.
That's crazy. Yeah.
That's crazy. That's real.
That's crazy.
Yeah. That happened. Continue. That was crazy. That was nice.
And so my spiritual spirituality, man, has been such a great instrument on this walk because I think there's space for Jesus and therapy. I think there's space to understand that when God made us, right, he made mental health. I mean, you think about Jesus' story, right? There's a scripture that says he grew in wisdom, he grew in stature, and, you know, also he grew amongst men. So that was three phases. He grew mentally, he grew physically, he grew spiritually, and then he grew in how he related to men. And so that's mental health. And to be able to connect the dots, and again, going back to when God gave me that word in 2015, now it all makes sense. Because I said, well, God, if it wasn't me, who would it have been? And so now when I look at where I'm at with being this face of Black mental health and all these different things, and it wasn't until, I can't remember, it was when I did a major interview, I was in my hotel room and God says, this is why I told you to go back to school. Look at how your voice is helping so many men. You know, I mean, because brothers was dropping. You know what I mean? 21, 22, just dropping. I mean, my phone was just blowing up. You know, my husband took his life. My husband, you know what I mean, and son. One lady said, my husband and son both took their life. One mom says, both of my sons, Jay, took their life 1 year apart.
Jesus Christ.
And I mean, this was like ongoing, bro. Ongoing. And because when you're going through your suffering, you don't see a way out. You see the suffering. And that's what I was seeing. And now I'm like, wow, this is what the journey was about. Because God says, now that you're free, now you can free them. And many times, We have people that are not free trying to free people.
That's right.
You know, and so my walk, man, with God, my walk in this space, man, has been something that I just wanted to play ball. I didn't see any of this field. Like, I didn't see therapists and, you know, doing TV shows and doing, like, I didn't see none of this. I just, and especially after football and even after, you know, going to therapy, I said, all right, I can just go live a life and just, you know, just drift off. And God said, no. He said, your voice is needed. And the more that I am entering to the space of entertainment, like I'm executive producing a series next week in L.A. With Shoe Palace, Walking My Shoes, and it's like my first executive producing debut. And I'm looking in all these spaces, and he said, this is what, because when he says go into all the world, he's talking about the world. We often limit it to the four walls of church. But ministry is what we're doing. This is ministry. This podcast is ministry. You're meeting people where they are. We can't just limit ministry to church in Oregon and, you know, and like ministry is meeting people where they are. Bro, I had a guy, this was recently. We were having, he's suicidal and he's literally like, bro, I'm done. And he starts crying and he says, Jay, I don't need no therapist right now, bro. I don't need no speaker, no author. He just went down the list. He's like, man, I need a nigga. Just like that. He said, man, talk to me like a nigga. I switch. And he came calm down. He played ball in the NFL and I talked to him just like we're in the locker room. I said, nigga, what you think gonna happen? I said, this may end the pain here, but it's going to cause pain somewhere else in your family. I said, so nigga, you tell me. Like, we having this rough conversation. And he just calmed down. And it hit me. I want to go scripture. Paul said, I became all things to all men. He didn't need scriptures. He needed me to meet him right where he was at. And that's what this is all about. And that's cultural competence in real time. And that's what a white clinician can't provide. That's what a female can't provide, because in that moment, I had to become what he can only receive. He didn't need no methods of structural model. He didn't need no cognitive. He just needed me to come real with him. And he said, just be real. He said, man, am I throwing away my life? And I said, nigga, what you want? I said, either you want to live or you don't. And I mean, man, I'm talking about, bro, he just calm on down. And now, and here's the transition of it. Early that day, I prayed with him. And he came back. He said, bro, that prayer was beautiful, bro. But, and now he's because he said, Jay, I'm from the streets, bro. And he was my client for a year before he stopped therapy. And he was just like, man, I just need somebody to talk to me, man, for where I'm at. And he was like, you know how it is in the locker room, man. Ooh, I said, I know. And that's what this is about, man, meeting people where they are.
Meeting people where they are.
We sound crazy.
What keeps you up at night?
Wondering, man, how can I duplicate who I am? How can I reach more men?
That's always a sign of greatness. Anyone I've ever listened to is great was always wondering how they could do more.
Yeah, and when Shoe Palace came to me with this opportunity, man, I jumped on it. You know, I work with an all-black production team. I told them, I said, you know, I want to bring my own production team, and I laid out, you know, and all this stuff. I've always had this affinity for entertainment and producing and stuff. I was in stage plays and acting for like 10 years. And so they were kind of like, wow, you really know your way around. I said, yeah, this has always been something, you know, but I was doing other things. But that keeps me up at night, man. And that's when I told my manager, like, no, I want to do more stuff, building content for brothers. You know, I want to direct films that speaks to black men, you know, that's centered around fatherhood, you know, loss of a father, grief, sexuality, you know what I'm saying? Dealing with mother wounds. And a lot of us, if we were, you know, raised by a single mom, man, is great on one end, but then on the other end, you have to deal with being a surrogate husband. You know? So, you know, like, you know, taking care of financially and all this, and because, you know, it's good until it's like, okay, mom, you know, I've been there. And so creating images, man, and content that speaks to brothers, you know what I mean? And that really allows a brother to see himself in the characters or see himself in the story. Because, you know, I didn't realize how many brothers in the league that had struggled with what I struggled with, depression. You know what I mean? Because, again, it's like we all trying to keep our jobs and we all trying to, you know what I mean? Like, no. And I tell people, you haven't experienced anxiety until you get brought in on a 2-day contract. And they say, nigga, get it done or get out.
Get out.
So you ain't experienced anxiety, man.
Right.
And then the anxiety is for the guy who know they brought somebody in to take your position. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
so stress. It's like, man, and then you in camp, man. It's like these grown men with bills, with kids, wives, girlfriends, and all mistresses, like all, you know what I mean? So it's like, and that anxiety, because everybody talk about, man, I was boxing the other day, one of my kids played in the league, he said, Jay, I can tell you right now, every day, I look at men on the edge in the locker room. But you would never know it because everybody celebrates Sunday. But these men have lives Monday through Saturday. You know what I mean? Everybody celebrates when you, hey, I just did this deal and just blah, blah, blah. Like, but they don't know the headache, the work that it took. And then once you sign the deal, you got the anxiety, like, can I keep it?
Can I keep it?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yep. Can I sustain it? You know what I'm saying? And it's just like, again, going back to success become traumatizing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because now we have in the back of our heads, I got to do twice as much as him. Mm. We got to work 10 times as hard.
Man.
Yeah. It's crazy.
Timon's going through.
No, because, you're always taught, especially as a black person, as a black man, that you have to work.
Twice as hard
to keep that opportunity, to get that degree, to whatever it is. And it's like Phil and I are HBCU graduates. When you, the first day, first week you at HBCU is like, we're preparing you to work twice as hard when you go out in the world and get that job. So it's like, it's ingrained in you from the beginning to like go the extra mile all the time. And sometimes you just don't feel like doing that.
Be tired.
Tired.
Just like, I'm tired of, you know, writing that extra line or whatever it is, sending that extra email or whatever it is. Like, I'm just sick of this shit, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
Shout out to my HBCU, Norfolk State University. Don't think I'm just wearing anybody's sweatshirt. This is my alma mater.
We love Norfolk State, man. We've been there 3 times with the Jesse O'Bro tour.
Really?
Yeah, 3 times.
See?
Yeah.
See?
My school just, Virginia. We continue to just embrace greatness.
Well, I don't know if you've been to Benedict College in Columbia, South Carolina, but I'm going to shout my school out too. So.
Well, let's arrange it. Let's figure it out.
You know what? They did call me about a year ago to come do something for mental health. Benedict College, yeah.
Yeah.
Timon, you can facilitate here.
Yeah, we need to make something happen. Class of 09 here.
Yeah.
We sound crazy.
Tupac Shakur.
Yeah, man.
So, the month of May, I want to get this right, because I didn't know this until recently. May is Mental Health Awareness Month. When did this start? Do you know when this?
Give us the history.
Give us the history. I don't know. I didn't know. I didn't know. But I think that's dope. But.
Clinician, I am. Historian, I am not. I don't know, man. But it's become a big month, man. And which is ironic because June is Mental Awareness Month for men.
Oh.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. So
didn't know that either.
Yeah. Yeah, so.
Well, I'll be celebrating both months.
How about that? We're celebrating
May through June. Like,
this is definitely something we need to just keep the conversation going 365, because it's so easy to get caught up in, you know, this is May. This is Mental Health Awareness Month and then June, but just ongoing maintenance. And I'm just, like I said, I'm telling y'all my honest truth. Man, that therapy.
I know.
Having that in my life on a consistent basis. And I agree with you, like every couple of weeks I go, because it's a lot to process and a lot to unpack and just, but even just in the business that we're all in, you know, working in music and TV and film and podcasting, it's demanding.
It is.
It's demanding. And you have to find those ways to decompress. And my therapist has actually been a great outlet, because first I was like, man, this nigga gonna judge me, man. Like, all this. I'm alone, like, just, hey, man, like, I thought he was gonna quit, but nah, he was like, man, come on, man, this is what I mean, but just, we have a real good relationship, you know, I'll text, and if I need to talk, like, even leaving here, like, I can get him on the horn, like, it's that type of bond.
Necessary.
So, yeah, but I won't say his name, because I do want to respect my privacy.
Right.
But,
Respect your own privacy.
Respect my own situation.
So, Phil, let me ask you this. Yeah. What does self-care look like to you? How do you practice self-care?
You know what? That's something I'm still learning, because honestly, I came into the business at such a young age, and not having, I'm appreciative for my mother, single mom, worked 3 jobs to really provide. My dad came around in later years and was in and out, but the reality is I had to learn a lot on my own. Yeah. And I had to learn from this uncle or that uncle or people that were in the business, because I started in this business at 12.
Mm-hmm.
So learning from people that maybe I shouldn't have been learning from, but I picked up certain traits and
habits
and you know, you have fun and you're young and you got a couple of dollars in your pocket and you don't know the importance of rest and maybe you shouldn't do that substance, or you shouldn't drink that alcohol. You know, it's just you learn things and you're like, man, after a while, I don't like the way I feel. I don't, this is kind of masking just something that I'm experienced earlier in life. And I'm like, I'm drinking this extra drink or these four drinks or these five drinks because it's like masking something that is deeper and it needs to be addressed. And so once I had that kind of my own realization that, yo, I gotta do better. Because otherwise I was going down a really dangerous path. And man, I done lived like from my teens to my 20s, low key to the 30s, you know what I mean? Been a little, you know what I mean? But I've matured a lot though. Mm-hmm, like for real, I've really just spiritually, emotionally, but I got work to do. And so now I'm just now getting back into the physical side of it. Like, okay, let me just get back into working out. That helps me as well. Mm-hmm. Spiritually, I'm that's always interesting to me because I've studied so many different types of religions. Like I'm a Christian, but I've studied a lot because I'm a reader. Mm-hmm. So just that's always interesting, just the journey of life. But I'm super spiritual. I go to church here in Nashville, but also emotionally, just but that balance. Mm-hmm. That's what I've always struggled with. That balance on how to just take care of me. I'm so used to providing for others, be it family members or being that. Mm-hmm. Oh, you need this? I can help you with this, or just helping so many other people, artists, friends, executives, colleagues. But I had to remind myself I can't pour from an empty glass. And so at some points, the glass was almost empty. And my therapist helped me realize how to just do things that make me happy. So whether that's go hiking, read a book, go to the movies, you know, but then the relationship side of it, because, you know, for me, it's like I done been in a bunch of failed relationships. That also comes with its own set of guilt. And you're like, man, I failed again. And I beat myself up more than most. So it's just just something. But that balance is something that I'm learning day by day, and just finding those tools to help me navigate just on a day to day basis. But having that, you know, I've got an executive coach, I've got my pastor, and I also have got, like I said, my therapist. But those are three people that hold me accountable in different types of ways.
I don't know everybody's relationship status, but do you feel like, you know, relational-wise, especially when we're on the go and being people of influence or people in the public's view, dating, what's that like? Because I know for me it's been challenging.
Man, super chat, because they can hit that Google on us. Hit that Google, was that, you know what I mean? What you do, they kind of, okay, that net worth, because, you know, just they, that net worth. You know, this, that, producing this, okay, yeah, executive over there. It's just like people start, but it's, to me, you walk in blind. And my last relationship, that was extremely tough. That was extremely tough. Like, if you want to know why it didn't work because she was like, this is a different world for me. Like, I don't know. And it was very intimidating. As much as I tried to calm things down, it was just, man, just, you know, it's the perception of what we do. Like, it's a fast lifestyle. And just, and a lot of that is true, but, you know. But,
I understand that. I mean, it's also, there's a, entertainment industry has a lot of stereotypes. A lot of them are true. They've happened, but also they can define you before you're able to define yourself.
That's, you know what I'm saying? That's the problem that I always have. I feel I get tired because I always feel like I'm trying to overcompensate for what they think I am because I'm in the music business.
That's part.
You know what I'm saying? So, and that top with my commitment issues, which I haven't quite figured out how what that stemmed from and how to navigate that, but it keeps me single.
Yeah, see, finding the balance has been an issue for me because you know, for so long I wanted to be in the music industry. I worked to get here, and now that a door finally opens and you know things are happening, and I'm being presented with all these opportunities, and it's just like I don't want anything to
derail that.
Yeah.
That's me.
And I'm like, I can't really focus on cultivating a relationship right now because I'm in the moment. Like, I'm finally getting to a place where I've always wanted to be.
Right.
And then it's just like, I'm not even going to lie to you and say I can, you know, try to build something with you because I'm just not in that place where I even want to do that right now.
Yeah, I'm king workaholic.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know how much I fully believe in horoscopes, but we're definitely born 2-3 days apart from each other. And so, like, it's just, when my eye's on the prize, anything that feels like it's a distraction from that, almost becomes the enemy. Mm. And I can flip that fast. I'm just like, you trying to keep me off my course? Yep. And so that always, it ruins relationships.
Yeah.
And then also because the music business itself is so all-encompassing, it's about your physical, it's about your mental, it's about your finances, about everything, then a lot of times it also becomes your whole world. And so I don't really desire a woman in music. My whole life is music.
Mm. Yeah.
So it's hard to take time to find people outside of your industry when your whole world is your industry.
Yeah, that's true.
And the unfortunate thing about the entertainment industry specifically is that you don't necessarily have to be the brightest tool, the sharpest tool in the box to be good at entertainment. You can be smart. You can be talented. You can be pretty. You can be, and so where it usually falls short is like, I don't want to talk about my job when I get home.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I don't want you to be trying to get in the studio. I don't want you to be trying to write a song. I don't want you to. I don't want you.
Niggas trying to get published now.
Even if I'm a saint, right?
Yeah.
Then I don't even want you to even consider. I don't even want you to be jealous of the artist I'm listening with, because it's literally my job. You know what I'm saying? I want to come home and hear what you're doing and have real experiences outside of my annoyingly stressful, crazy, nonsensical industry. You know what I'm saying? So just not feeling like I have an escape from my job is my love, but it's also my stress. So I want to come home.
Oh, that's good. That's good. Yeah, man. You guys is that's good, man. Because for me, it's like, I want to be pulled out of it.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You know what I mean? Yes. Like, I don't want to talk about clients. I don't want talk about being on the road and touring and you know, who you're working with and stuff. I'm the same, man. Yeah. I was like, I just want to be.
Just want to be.
You know, just want to be, man. I just want to, you know, do my workouts and be invested into what she has going on.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think that's been the challenging part, going back to what Phil said, is like, I know I've done that and try to bring somebody along, but it's intimidating, you know? And we spend so much energy trying to comfort whatever insecurities they have.
Yeah.
And again, it's because we all have them. So it's, the insecurity part is not an issue. It's like, we all have them, but that takes energy within itself to comfort you.
That's right.
Like, if I brought you here, that means I want you here. Yeah. And there's something in you that I admire, respect, and adore that says that I'm going to bring you in this space. But then I don't want to get you in this space, and then I'm trying to comfort you on how to stay in it.
Yeah.
Because that now becomes draining for me.
Yeah.
You know, and
it's the same reason. It's the exact reason that I don't like birthday parties.
I want to hear it. Tell me more.
Because if someone, or rather, surprise birthday parties.
We are truly Capricorns.
Because
I'm the same way. I hate surprise parties.
The reason not that I don't like parties, I actually like to have a good time. Mm-hmm. It's the fact that when you walk in a room and everyone that you know is there to surprise you, then you don't actually enjoy the party, because now you're worried about making sure all these people from different walks of life are comfortable and that they feel valid in the room and that they got some cake. And you drink, you like the music we're playing, you like the DJ, and so actually you end up more exhausted about your own party than just realizing that, oh, everyone's here to celebrate me. And that's how I feel about, that's kind of how dating feels sometimes. It's kind of like, but I just want to go and just have a good time. I don't want to be worried about your comfort level. I don't want to worry about what's going to happen or the positioning of it all, because my life is positioning.
Mm-hmm.
I just want to I want to just enjoy it. And so it scares me, especially as I get older, it scares me how comfortable I am in my solitude.
Claude.
Bro. Because you want to cash out from something right now?
Yeah. He's literally telling my story right now.
Because I take cash out, Venmo,
and Zelle. I feel like that ministers to you. I feel like that really ministers to my
mom. I've known him for how many years now? And it's
many
just like,
years. It's scary though, because I am in my turtle shell and I'm good.
Yes.
Like, I can be good in my turtle shell, fully entertained and having a good time. And so, my I don't not a resolution, but I'm I'm trying to remind myself of the things I love outside of music, first of all, and just accepting the fact that without trying, you'll meet people that are interesting just by doing those things. Mm. Just by having that. You might just meet the cashier at the place that's outside of your comfort zone, and that might lead to a person.
Nice
that leads
cashier.
To a person.
Yeah.
At a Whole Foods or something.
It's got to be Whole Foods.
She can count. She can count.
Yeah.
So, no, you know what I'm saying? Like, just trying to, like I like horseback. I love horseback riding. I haven't done it in years. Travel was, pandemic was hard because it kept me locked in, and I like to travel. Traveling opens my brain up.
Yeah, same.
And it reminds me that the world is small but big. Mm. And so it's never as bad as it seems, and it's never as unrelatable as it feels to you. So trying to make time outside of work, because by the way, work makes us travel, but that's still business.
Yeah.
But travel for pleasure and leisure and for education, and just letting whatever happens when you do that happen. That's my goal.
Oh, that's beautiful, man.
It seemed to me that, and y'all could weigh in on it, but it seems to me that dating is a little different now. You know, I think once the term toxic masculinity was introduced into the marketplace, for lack of a better word, I think people have an unhealthy way of dealing with strong-minded men. You know what I'm saying? Like, we can become anything. We can become demonized instantly.
Oh, yeah.
Instantly.
Off something that's just a characteristic of a strong-minded man, or that's just a characteristic of a black man, or that's just a characteristic of somebody that grew up in East St. Louis. You can be demonized. And so I find myself choosing to be by myself because I don't want to walk on eggshells, because I have to be me. You know what I'm saying? Like, I have to do that, like, no matter what. And so it just becomes challenging.
Well, I'm single and ready to mingle again.
I am single as a Pringle and ready to mingle.
My IG is at the bottom of the screen. I'm accepting DMs.
Billionaire rhymes with billionaire. We sound crazy as single, bro.
We are.
This is so good.
I mean, this has been one of the best conversations I think we've had on the podcast.
Yes.
It relates to all of us, and it's music adjacent.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I like that. Mm-hmm.
But it permeates into everything that we're all doing in real life. So you got to come back a gazillion times.
Yeah, absolutely, man. Yeah. Love to, man. This was fun.
It's not New Year's or anything, but I'd love to hear from everyone, starting with you, of course. Like, what's something that you've promised yourself this year, this week, whatever, that you're gonna do better at? You're gonna be better.
Remain in a state of ease. And that's something. I took a sabbatical at the beginning of this year. I went to Seattle, went up in the mountains, and I wrote out my vision. I wrote out everything that I heard. I wrote out everything that I foresee or foresaw. And I just wrote out everything that I felt that I was called to for this year. And the word that just kept coming to me was ease. Mm. And that ease was the stillness, whether it's a yes or whether it's a no. Mm. I have ease. I think last year, you know, when we were doing a tour, man, it was just, again, I was dating and I was in a relationship distance-wise, and I had the tour, man. It was, man, it was so much. I couldn't get my workouts in. I was all over the place, man. So I was very unsettled. Mm. And one of the things that I said to myself this year, no matter what was going on, I was gonna always find a place of ease. Mm. I was driving here in the, I hung out with my mom and sisters last night. You know, we just did like a little family thing. And she called me this morning. She said, "I've never seen you in this place of peace."
Mm. Mm.
She said, "Me and your sister was talking about it." She said, "I don't know, Jay just got this peace around him, just ease." And I said, "Mama, that's what I've been working on."
Mm.
Because life is hard for us as black men.
Yeah, man.
Going back to what you said, man, Chuck, I feel that a lot, especially being a strong black man who's assertive.
Mm-hmm.
Because oftentimes our assertiveness is interpreted as aggressiveness.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's just kind of like, I'm just saying no. Like, I'm not saying like, no. But, if you have not heard no from a man who is secure, you interpret it as, oh, he's controlling. It's like, no, I'm just saying no. Like, I'm not going for that. But and I've dealt with that so much in relationships is trying to, like, man, do I, you know, kind of mm-hmm. going to shell. And, yeah. But then I'm like, that's not me because I'm not a passive guy,
right. mm-hmm.
you know? And so it can be tough, man. And what I did this year is like, man, I just want to be settled in just who I am and who I'm becoming.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm okay with that.
Yes, sir.
And I don't, you know, like I said, when I turned 40, man, it's like a light bulb just came on to where I just like, this is where I'm at mm-hmm. in my thought process. And like, I desire peace.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to continue to get the bag and do all the great things that we're doing. But man, I want a life of ease.
Yeah.
And I never forget my therapist asked me, says, what would joy feel like?
I'm saying, like, imagine that. You know what I'm saying?
Imagine that. And now I am reimagining what joy looks like from a relational standpoint, from a business standpoint, from if it goes different direction, like, and we have to service ties, it's okay.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't have to be this knockout, drag out. It's just because I feel like we place so much emphasis on wanting to be right. And my thing is, I don't have to be right.
Mm-hmm.
If there's understanding, I'm okay. Yes or no. And that's the ease I want to stay in, mm-hmm. man. Because, you know, the average black man lives 59 years.
Wow.
I don't like that number.
Man, I don't like that number.
Right.
I'm not 59. Like that number, Phil.
I want to be over there with Barry Gordy and Quincy.
I want to be on that side. I want to be 90.
59?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I don't like that number.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And
I rebuke that number.
Man, what?
Rebuke it. I don't want that number. Later. I don't want to rebuke it for earlier. I want it for later. Like, you have to be specific.
Like, I mean, you just think about that, man. I mean, you know, most of us are just now hitting our top earning power.
Yeah.
Right?
They say life begins at 40.
Exactly. Right? And so, you know, you have worked through the process in your 30s and late, and it's just like, I don't want to get through my 40s and all of a sudden it's a heart attack and it's over.
Yeah.
And it's because of the stress. Yeah. You know, and so, and we don't take care of ourselves as men. Again, mm-hmm. woman, we make sure everyone else is good but yep. ourselves. And by the time the brother goes to the doctor says, well, if you'd have got here a year later, we could have saved you.
Yeah, yeah.
So
yeah.
It's like,
it's too late.
Yeah, so, man, I just want us to have a better quality of life, man. We, you know, we deserve it. And for that reason, I buy myself flowers every week because I told my mother, you know, God forbid, I said, baby, I want to make sure I celebrate me and buy flowers.
Yeah.
I don't want all these flowers at my funeral. Mm-hmm. I can't smell them.
Right. That's true.
Miley said I could buy myself flowers. You know what I'm saying?
Oh man, it's you're talking about cathartic.
Yeah.
Oh man.
I love flowers.
Every week, man, I put my arrangements together. My vision is after I graduate in August with my doctorate, I'm gonna open up a flower shop for men in Dallas.
I love that.
Called Blowers, Brother Who Love Flowers.
Flowers. Mm.
And so, yeah, and because I want brothers to, you know, to just have joy, man.
Yeah.
And I, you know, when I did that interview with Charlamagne, the Breakfast Club, bro, I had like 200 DMs from men when they released it. And brothers, I'm talking about brothers sending voice texts crying, like, bro, can I get in and see you? Man, bro, I'm struggling. And, man, that just broke my heart, man. Mm. That how we don't get to experience joy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But we provide it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely yeah. providers.
We provide it for everybody,
mm-hmm.
you know, and they was like, well, you're making money, but it's like, but you're tired. You don't enjoy it. You go on a trip with your family. The kids have a good time. You're too tired to have sex with your wife. It's just like, mm-hmm. then you got to grab your blue pill and then you hope that working time enough, man. All these scenarios that I have to hear, bro, it's crazy,
yeah.
man. And I mean, it's just like, and so when we should be really living in our 40s, brothers are in the hospitals.
Yeah. Real talk.
You know,
it's real talk.
We sound crazy.
You talk about your friendship with Charlamagne. I know, like, you two do a lot together. Speaking engagements, you've been on The Breakfast Club. You've been on his television show as well. How did you and Charlamagne connect?
Man, so how I really got discovered, man, like, I've been speaking and doing stuff for years, but what really launched me is Taraji's. People hit me up when she was getting ready to launch her Boris Henson Foundation, providing therapy for black men, which is a foundation that she created, that she named after her father. And so they reached out to me and they was like, yo, man, you know, Taraji loves your work. We want you to work with her pro bono. I said, okay, yeah. So, and I joined the team and was helping in the back office stuff. And one day they emailed me and they was like, hey, Taraji is going on The Breakfast Club and she wants you to go. with her to represent, you know, black men and as a therapist. And so I go on there, man, and I got this hoodie on that says heal. And the moment I get on and, you know, Charlamagne's like, yo, man, I love that hoodie. I said, yeah, bro, you know, I get you one. So everybody's in their phone. It's virtual because it's during the pandemic. Oh, gotcha. And so we're all on there, man. And so we get into the interview, man, and, you know, I just went to work. I just started flowing. And as soon as the interview over, Charlamagne was like, bro, we got to stay in touch. And so we started, we connected then, man. And then that following year, I did the Breakfast Club in studio. And so we just kept building, man. And kind of like I do you, man, I sent them voice text, voice messages, man. You know, just different things, man. And what I do is whenever I build a relationship with people, I always go into it what I bring to it, not what I'm wanting to get out of it. So there's the genuineness of the brotherhood that we built because he saw a brother to where I not only just celebrated him, but there was a place where he can just be. Like, when I'm checking on him, like, I don't care what is going on with the podcast, the Breakfast Club, man, how you doing, bro? And we just sit up and chop it up, you know, nothing. And so that brotherhood was so important because I remember when he started talking about therapy, you had dudes out here like, oh, he a simp, ain't going to therapy. But, man, it was a grown man discussion he was having. And I wanted to know, wanted him to know that I celebrated him and honored him for it and applauded him, man, for evolving. Again, why do we want to stay the same?
Right.
And then we shame brothers who said, man, I'm thinking differently now. No, yeah, I know that's what you guys knew me for, but this is what I'm on now. And it's just almost going like, again, you demonize for turning your life around. And it's like, where's the grace? You know? And so, and we just started building, man. And I love him to the moon and back, man. I'm proud of his growth and just proud of him because without him or Taraji, there's no Jay Barnett that the world is coming to know daily for how I share in this space. And I credit both of them for seeing the weight that my voice carried clinically and, you know, just as a black man. And that's been great to build with him and other guys, man, in the industry, man, to have a relationship with these guys where they can have a space where we just chop it up, man. And it ain't on, you know, can you bring me on here? Like, I, you know, it's like it was never there for me. It was always like, man, just being a safe space, man. Because again, I grew up in a family full of pro athletes. And so I saw so much done that I'm like, man, who are the people that you have to go talk to before you make this decision? You know, so it's, and I think the industry needs more of that with these young artists, man. It's just like, there was this one artist reached out, I won't say his name, but man, I just, man, my heart just broke for this guy, man. And very talented and gifted, man. But it was just the weight he's carrying, you know, the expectations and, you know, the weight that he's carrying of, you know, how do I navigate this space? Because now I got this bag. Now I got to produce. But now I'm introduced to a world that I really wasn't ready for. You know, and so who are those persons that can stand next to them and not exploit these people? Because most of the time, they're getting people who exploit them. They get in, they get close, and boom, they run to a blog. They get in, they get close, and they run to. It's like, man, and I tell all these guys, be sure to have people who care about you. Not what you do, not what you can provide about you. That if you are in a corner, in a room, there was a football player that I saw, he asked me to meet him at a deli, and he wanted to talk. And we sat out there and talked, bro, it started raining. And so, you know, I'm like, okay, he ain't moving. He kept talking. And he turned his phone over to stop his phone from getting wet. And he just kept talking. And it poured down, and I sat right there. And he didn't stop talking, and I didn't stop listening. And I said, man, what if these artists, these men in these high places had people to sit with them in the rain?
Wow.
Mentorship, mentorship is so rare. That's real, man.
Yeah. Wow.
We sound crazy.
Esther Roll
Award.
Looking at my role, it's about that time.
About that time, yo.
For the Irby Award, the Esther Roll Black Excellence Award. Now, Jay, you don't, it might sound crazy. I'm going to explain to you what it is. So, we start this podcast. Timon to your right, the audience is left, came in playing. He's like the music. We all know music, but he's like, he has records and crates.
Aficionado.
The aficionado, if you will. So, he brought in this album by Esther Roll from. Who played Florida Evans in Good Times. She had a gospel album called The Garden of My Mind. That's what you just heard. So we were like, we didn't even know she did that. So we started this whole conversation about how we need to take time to award Black entertainers, celebrities, leaders that don't get the shine they deserve. Just because that's sometimes that's how life is uneven, right?
Right.
So we created an award, the Esther Roll Black Excellence Award, shortened into the IRBY. Every episode, we all of us nominate somebody and we vote. And then we give the actual award to whoever wins. There have been some heated debates in the past, but I feel like we have some smart people here today. So really, it's open. Like, it could be any, it don't have to be a musician or it could be any kind of person. But we tend to lean towards music, but that's not the rules. So I want to open the floor to nominate someone. You know, Phil, I know you have a brilliant idea boiling in there.
Man, come on, man. Don't put me on the spot, man. No, but you know, since it is May, Mental Health Awareness Month, you know, we've been talking about this all episode. But mental health aside, this individual has been a trailblazer in many regards, an amazing actress, philanthropist. Jay talked about her just a little bit ago. Taraji P. Henson.
Yeah. I think that's a very good person to nominate as well.
Yeah.
Timon, who you got?
So when we talk about L.A. Reid and Babyface, there's a third person that I consider the secret sauce to a lot of the hits that they made over the years. And I'm talking about Daryl Simmons.
Yeah. Daryl Simmons.
No one ever – I really don't think a lot of people know who he is. I mean, he's still making great music. He's done some amazing records in the last year or so on the latest After 7 record. But – yeah, Daryl Simmons is my nomination this week.
That's cool.
Bob Kelly, who you got?
I'm going to nominate Akon.
Okay.
Akon.
I'm going to tell you why, because this conversation reminded me of how important mentorship is and Black men taking a chance on Black men. And he's one of the first artists to ever give me a shot in this business without too many strings attached. He was just like, you're dope. Get under my wing. Let me help you out. Let me put you on. Call me anytime. Wow. I'd call him anytime in the middle of the night. He'd come to the studio and hear what I was working on, all that kind of stuff. So I don't think I get to honor him enough publicly, but Akon has been a big brother and a mentor when I needed it, when I could have really gotten used and played in the top of my career. Mm-hmm. So I'm nominating Akon.
That's a good one.
Chuck Harmony.
I'm going to nominate Gil Scott-Heron. Yeah, he gets overlooked for his influence on hip-hop, but as we were sitting there and we was listening to Tupac and talking about Jay-Z and Ether, and it just reminded me that we gotta celebrate the people that inspired those people.
True. Jay, who you got?
Man, I'm going to have to partner with old Phil, go with my good friend Taraji P. Henson, and I say her because she has, you know, single-handedly, man, shifted the world in this space of mental health.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you see mental health being talked about now in the entertainment industry, in Hollywood, music, just everyday living, man. And I think, you know, we had been so focused on living life, but we weren't focused on being.
Mm-hmm.
You know, or should I say, we was more focused on doing rather than being. And I think she has done a lot. Of course, we love her work that she's done as an actress, but her work as a philanthropist and her foundation, man, is afforded me the opportunity to, you know, how people have come to know the work that I've done and just hearing my story, you know. And I always say, man, you know, without her bringing me on the Breakfast Club, there is no relationship with, you know, friendship with Charlamagne and so on and so forth, man. And so I have to nominate her, man, because I feel like, you know, as a Black woman, you know, I stand on her shoulders, you know what I mean, in this movement, because, you know, it takes a black woman to move these initiatives, you know what I mean? I mean, they can go and get it done. She's opened the door for black men to begin healing because her foundation provides free therapy for these brothers, you know, who can't afford it. I just think that's so paramount, man, because it's, you know, you look at where we are right now as a state of being, a lot of this is associated with things that we didn't get. Mm-hmm. And so being able to provide resources to brothers, man, who would never go. And just to know that there's this amazing black woman that is advocating for them, man, is amazing. And so, yeah, I have to, you know, give that award to her because it's, I mean, man, you know, you think about it, mental health now is more serious than it's ever been.
Oh, yeah.
And we should have always been taking it serious because how do you not talk about mental health and talk about life in the same sentence?
Like, you can think about how many of our greats we lost because it wasn't popular enough to have been a real issue.
Man.
Most of the black icons suffered from loneliness and lack of compassion and companionship.
And real community.
Real community and real therapy.
Yup, that's mad.
Scary. I don't know, we have to stand on our shoulders. Some people have to sacrifice for us to get here, but there's still some tragedy in that.
Man, right?
We can look back and like, damn, if we had just...
Yeah.
Like, I think about Juice WRLD all the time, man. Like, I don't know if you guys seen that documentary, man. Mm-hmm. I love that kid, man. Yeah, man. Oh, my gosh, man. Love that kid. And I just always think, as I was watching documentary, man, somebody just could have grabbed him.
Mm-hmm. He was so gifted.
Too. Yeah, so brilliant. So brilliant, man. Mm-hmm.
So just to recap, we got nominations this week for Taraji P. Henson, Daryl Simmons, Akon, and Gil Scott-Heron. So, Jay, at this point, we vote. You can vote more than once if you desire.
Show of hands.
And we'll crown a winner. So up first, Taraji P. Henson.
That's a sweep right there.
That's five right there. Daryl Simmons, legend.
Three.
Four.
I'm bad to see something.
Akon.
Y'all are haters.
Gil Scott-Heron.
It's obvious then. You know, it goes to Taraji P.
Taraji P. Henson, congratulations. Yeah. You are the winner of the Esther Roll Black Excellence Award.
I hate you, Jody.
That's where all my instantly goes.
And shout out to our affiliate HUR Voices. You know, Taraji's a DC. Shout out to everybody in the DMV, but DC specifically. Congratulations, Taraji. We'll send you the award.
We'll send it with Jay.
Yeah.
We sound crazy.
Listen, this has been enlightening, inspiring, encouraging, right on time. Crazy timing. I mean, like I said it several times, but you have to come back because I think this is not a conversation you have once. It's a conversation you have many times to remind ourselves and everyone who's listening that your mental health, your physical health, your spiritual health are all tied together, right? So we're formally inviting you back. And we don't know when, but you're invited back whenever you want to. You can come back and kick it and preach to the people anytime you want to.
Man, thank you guys, man. This has been awesome, man. Made my Friday, brother.
We're going actually, because Kirk Franklin and I have these discussions. He's another one that's super vocal about mental health and his family and everything. So there's a few people I want to assemble a special episode in the near future. I got some ideas.
A nice little caucus, if you
will. Yeah,
caucus.
A caucus.
Yeah.
Caucus.
Exactly. Yo, Phil, I was trying to think of, we should ask you. When we go out, right, we pick a song that you think best feels like it encompasses the conversation or the vibe or the feeling of the episode. But while you're brewing on that, I'm going to ask Phil to do all the necessary thank yous and stuff.
And it can be Jeffrey Osborne
It can be Jeffrey Osborne.
I'm only human.
If you feel like we've neglected Jeffrey O, you can always drop him in right now.
Make sure you follow us on all platforms at We Sound Crazy and WeSoundCrazy.com. Special shout out to our partners at the National Museum of African American Music, BlackMusicMuseum.org. And we can't forget, visit Music City.
Cannot.
There's our peoples over there. So come to Nashville, come visit. We here. Oh, yeah. Go get this book.
I can't wait to dig into this.
Just Hill, bro. Available everywhere books are sold.
It's a journal for everybody.
Yeah, absolutely. So go support. Other than that, thank you, Mike Guru Johnson, our producer. Thank you, Travis and Joey behind the camera. Kaylee snapping away back there on the BTS.
What up? All right, Jay. This is your moment right here. This is what it all comes down to.
Y'all gonna bug out on this one.
Hit us with the jam.
Sammy Davis, I Gotta Be Me.
Okay.
I love that.
Yeah.
I love it.
See, you didn't think that was coming. You thought it was gonna be Jeffrey O.
All right, until next week. Thank you, Jay Barnett.
Man, thank you.
Appreciate it.
Yes,
thank
sir.
You. Yes, we out of here. Until next week, y'all.
Peace.
We sound crazy. I gotta be me.